Coming to you from Forager Brewery in Rochester, our town.
And welcome to Our Town, the show about Rochester. I'm Eric Olson. Glad you're with us tonight. Special show, royalty is in the house. Madeline Van Erd is a Rochester native and recently won the crown of Miss Minnesota. And she's with us today. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
And congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Notice how she's standing so straight and tall so that the crown doesn't
fall off.
Do you have it affixed there with super glue or a few pins?
Stapled it right on the head. No, they're just pins across the band on the top.
What a thrill. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Named last month.
That's
right?
Correct. Yes, I was crowned.
What was that process like? It's been a long, long go for you.
Yes, well, this was my second year at the Miss Minnesota pageant. But as far as my year this year went, I was crowned in earlier this spring as Miss River Valley, which was representing the Stillwater area. And then I went through the Miss Minnesota week, which we stay and we do a bunch of appearances throughout the week, and then compete also on stage during the week too for the crown. So.
And then the pageant itself, is it a live type? You don't know what's going to happen.
No, we do not. So it is some raw emotion up there, absolutely. Mm-hmm. So it happens all live, and we have two preliminary nights leading up to the finals night, where then the top 11 compete for the title on the finals night. And so we compete in interview earlier in the week, and then we do our talent on stage, lifestyle and fitness, evening gown, and then an on-stage question as well. So.
And what's the role these days of Miss Minnesota in the state?
Yeah, well, there are, I think, a lot of different ways, and I think that each title holder is a little bit different. For me, I just want to be a really big advocate for the arts in the community, as well as representing service in the state. There's a lot of service. The service aspect is really big for the
pageant. So do you go to different communities? Will you go and, like, I don't know, meet at the Rotary Club, or do you go to schools and sing? Because you have a beautiful voice and you play piano.
Yes.
Is it more performance that you do to promote the arts? Any idea how that will unfold?
Yeah, well, it can be a little bit of everything. I mean, I have been invited many places to perform, but for me, what's really so cool is making it an interaction. I like to go places and interact with the audience and be a part of it as well and let them join in and sing songs with me. I was actually up in Moorhead yesterday and we did a little impromptu performance of Don't Worry, Be Happy. And so that was really cool. And I just love that sort of conversation piece and really having a good conversation with the audience as well.
And you exude positivity, which, if I can say, in our society, we need more of, really. Is that part of the Miss Minnesota pageant, is to be positive as far as guiding principles go?
Oh, absolutely. And I think really, yeah, standing up for what was right and being a really positive force in the community and representing really great things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And music, I've heard that you come from a rather musical family. Tell me about that.
Oh, yes, it's so funny because our last name is Van Erd, right? And so people always joke because we would go on these walks and my dad would bring his guitar and we'd all sing as we walked down the side of the road that we were like the Von Trapp family singers. So they would call us the Van Erd family singers.
Very good.
Yeah, so we have a lot of fun.
Yeah, graduated from Mayo, Rochester Mayo.
That's correct.
Did you know early on that you were involved, interested in pageants? Is this something that one pursues from a very young age?
I think it can be. I think for me, it was something that I wasn't very exposed to until I was more in my adult life. And really, I knew in my life that I wanted to have a way to share my music and my gifts with others and help others. Those are kind of my passions. And throughout high school, those were things that I did. And I wasn't really aware that the, you know, Miss America organization was a place where that could really come together, but it really has. And over the past 2 years, I've had incredible opportunities to grow myself and also share my gifts with others. So it's been very empowering.
And talk about Fine Arts for Kids.
Yes, well, Fine Arts for Kids is a pilot program that I began a few years ago here in Rochester, actually, through the public school system, which is the basis for my platform for Miss America. And so it was a program where I provided free arts education to kids on free and reduced lunches in the public school system. And so for me, it developed into my platform, which is titled The Arts Project. And it sort of is twofold. At first is about emphasizing the importance of the arts in our communities and in our youth, as well as encouraging community members to really take responsibility for the youth in the community and provide those needs and not look to some outside force to provide them for it. Now, we're not getting the funding that we need for the arts right now, so what I'm saying is, why not us? Why can't we take these gifts and this education that we've received and give it back in that way? So, yes, it's
kind of head off shortfalls of spending. That's great.
Absolutely.
What happens next in the pageant world for you?
Well,
is there the nationals?
Yes, Miss America is in September. The finals night is September 11th. I just got back from orientation, which we had in DC, actually. I know, it's crazy. It's finally feeling real to me, you know? I mean, at first it's been kind of a whirlwind, and now it's really settling in that this is something I actually get to do. I've watched the Miss America pageant since I was a little girl, and to think that I'm actually a part of that now is absolutely incredible.
How wonderful for you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you for the time.
Oh, it's my pleasure. This
coming
has been incredible.
To Forager here in Rochester, Madeline Van Aert, the 2016
Miss Minnesota.
Miss Minnesota.
Oh, very good.
Is brought to you in part by the following amazing people and organizations.
Clements Subaru, proudly partners with award-winning KSMQ Public Television. Clements Subaru of Rochester. Clements' clear value promise is to make buying a car fast, fair, and simple. The University of Minnesota Rochester, an undergraduate health sciences university offering education designed to change tomorrow's healthcare. University of Minnesota Rochester, always in the heart of our community. The Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota.
And the members of KSMQ Public Television. Thank you.
Stick around, we have more great stories coming up. We learn more about how IBM ended up in Rochester. Friendship had a lot to do with it. We're in the middle of national convention season, and we have two local experts to talk about what the Republican and Democrats are thinking. And it's a beautiful day for a trip to Quarry Hill Nature Center. Up next, our town culture enjoys the grandeur of organ music.
Hello, my name is Brian Polk, and I'm the organist and choir director here at Trinity Lutheran Church in downtown Rochester, Minnesota. The event you're going to be seeing is our noonday organ recitals that happen here every Tuesday for the entire summer, June, July, and August. We do it here at Trinity for 6 weeks. We exclude the week of the 4th of July, and then next week it'll be over at Christ United Methodist Church, which is at the corner of 4th Street and 4th Avenue Southwest. We keep it simple. We ask each organist to do a selection of the music they would like to do and keep their concert between 30 and 40 minutes. Organists range from anywhere locally. We get quite a few out of the Twin Cities. This year we had a gentleman come up last week, Paul Solick from Seward, Nebraska. Just depends on who we can find and who's willing to do it. Today, Mary Newton is playing, and she is from St. Barnabas Lutheran Church up in Plymouth, Minnesota. They get to select all of the music that they want to select. It can be any type of style, or whether it's spiritual, religious, or not. The audience shows up here. We usually see a crowd between 75 and 100. They are people that work at Mayo Clinic. There's people that are downtown. A couple weeks ago, we had a family camping from Nebraska down in Lanesboro, and they saw it on Google and decided to drive up for it. And then other organists in the community. and our own church members, of course. The organ is a Wicks organ now. It started out as a Reuter 10 years ago, 11 years ago. We had it completely rebuilt. It's the equivalent of about 68 ranks. It's a three-manual organ, and manual simply means how many keyboards and then a full pedal board down below. It is a pipe organ with some digital augmentation, so we do have some digital stops on it also. It means that they are sampled sounds taken from other organs around the world and then pushed through a very elaborate speaker system, and then the pipes are temperature sensitive so that the pipe organ is always in tune with the electronic part of the organ. I think it's the majesticness of this organ, or of any organ. They call it the king of instruments. It can be very big and bold. It can be very soft and somber, and it really can be anything you want it to be, and it's all done by one person. So it's an entire orchestra put together here at this council. This is kind of the brains, and then the pipes and blower system and everything is off to the sides. I think the audience really gets to hear a lot of organ music in a very short period of time. It's very entertaining, it's very moving, and it's a nice little break in the week. And usually in the summer, we've got this nicely air-conditioned, as like today, very warm, that gives them a chance to come in and just simply cool off and simply meditate to some wonderful music.
It's all about you, Rochester. Send us a picture of your favorite feature of Rochester. Rochester@ksmq.org. Don't let nothing hold down. Nothing holds down.
Hey, work hard and maybe you can be like one of these guys. Would you like that? Maybe be one of the, holding the big trophy like that? Well, the winners of the Scripps National Spelling Bee, you could do it. Rock the Hive, an adult spelling bee is coming up in October. So now is your chance to start polishing up your spelling skills. Individuals and teams can enter, and proceeds go to help the Youth Spelling Bee program along with other student events. You can check it out at ssc.coop. Week number 3 of Down by the Riverside series is this coming Sunday night featuring John Party. Down by the Riverside offers free concerts, of course, at Mayo Park in a variety of genres. And this is their 25th year. This week it's country music. Next week, Lucius makes another run. Last year, those of you who are fans may recall the concert was cut short because of bad weather by a storm that blew through. And then the big finale is on August 21st. The band is Creedence Clearwater Revisited. You can get the full schedule at riversideconcerts.com. And did you hear the big announcement yesterday? Rochester Civic Music bringing Winona to town. Winona. That's how I know how to say it. Winona. Steve and Chris do a great job down there making sure Rochester Entertainment is at its best. And finally, great turnout, the DMC project at Pitch Night for the Placemakers Prototypes. As you can see, Rochester is full of many creative people. Stay with us as we enjoy a little peace and quiet at the Quarry Hill Nature Center. That's coming up next on Our Town Walkabout.
Hi, welcome to the Our Town Walkabout. My name is Lori Forsty, and I'm Public Relations Coordinator here at Quarry Hill Nature Center. I'm going to give you a little bit of tour today of the Interpretive Center and Quarry Hill Park. We're here in the Butterfly Garden at Quarry Hill Nature Center. It's in full bloom right now and attracting butterflies of all sorts. This is a special place here at the center where you can observe butterflies. In addition to that, we do some monarch tagging programs that anyone can participate in. We'll capture monarchs, put a tag on them, record some data about them, and you're a part of a citizen research project. Quarry Hill Park is about 329 acres on the east side of Rochester. Just kind of right in the heart of the city is this beautiful landscape. There's pond, there's forest. We have a restored oak savanna here, an old working quarry that you can now explore and fossil hunt as well as see. In addition to that, the Old State Hospital Cemetery is here in the park. And two playgrounds on the west and the north entrance. This is the Harry S. Buck Children's Pond. This Harry was our founding director here at Quarry Hill Nature Center. We know that kids that spend time in nature, they do better in school, they have better mental health, their physical fitness improves. Helping them connect and providing them with experiences to engage their senses is of the utmost importance. Thanks for letting me show you around Quarry Hill Park and Nature Center. We hope to see you here soon.
Coming up soon, our Republican and Democratic experts right here.
Our roundtable, the big question, who's coming out on top in 2016?
Stick around.
Our past, remembering what made us who we are today. Brought to you by the History Center of Olmsted County.
In late December 1942, Air Force pilot Leland Fiegel returned to his native Rochester after conducting an extensive mission in Moscow with his co-pilot, Tom Watson Jr. This serendipitous pairing led to an IBM plant in Rochester, for Watson was the son of IBM's founder. In the mid-1950s, IBM, with Watson now at the helm as CEO, was expanding and in search of a new plant site. With a strong presence on the East and West Coasts, where labor costs and labor unrest were high, IBM looked to the Midwest as an alternative. As many as 80 cities were considered, but when presented with the final two options, Madison, Wisconsin, or Rochester, Minnesota, Watson chose Rochester, partly in honor of his friend. A 570,000 square foot facility opened in September 1958. Thus, thanks to two friends, IBM turned Rochester into a technology hub and contributed to its economy, population, and development.
Republicans are finishing up their time in the spotlight, and the official nomination of Donald Trump and Mike Pence as the top of the ticket is now formal. The Democrats are gearing up for their time together to nominate Hillary Clinton and her running mate.
We're going to have some fun now. We have two local experts in politics joining us to talk about what's happening at the national level and how it might impact us in southeastern Minnesota and Rochester. Welcome to Minnesota Representative Kim Norton. Former Representative Bill Kuisle. Thank you very much, folks.
Nice to be here.
And thank you both for your service. I think we don't say that enough because it's a lot. It's a big commitment to serve in government.
That is, and thank you for that. Yeah.
No, and things are changing so fast too, and the dynamics of what goes on has gotten a bit rougher. So it's hard on people, and people don't understand that, what it's like to be in a public spotlight.
So our big question is, who's coming out on top in 2016?
You gonna arm wrestle for it?
Hillary Clinton will be the next president.
I believe that the country is leaning towards Donald, and I think all you have to do is look at Britain, where they just did that vote, and people want to change, and people are not happy with the economies that are going on now, and they're afraid of terrorism. And they want to know who's going to address it and how they're going to address it.
From when you watch TV and you listen to the network people talk, they talk about coattails, like whoever you vote for at the top of the ticket might impact who you are going to push, the lever you're going to push, Republican or Democrat. Kim, does that trickle all the way down to state offices, do you think? Do you see an impact?
It can sometimes, and we do know that when there's a good turnout, Democrats do well. I think that's one of the things that we'll be looking for. We know that the Republican Minnesota Convention didn't support Donald Trump. In fact, looked for a more reasonable candidate. And I think we will see the effects of that in our local races. So let's talk a little bit. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, I think there's also a split yet that hasn't been healed in the Democratic Party with Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton. And that's one of the things that is still going to play out is that going to come together? And this next week will be interesting to see if the Democrats have come together. We saw it somewhat last night with Ted Cruz not coming on board. But
does that impact, though, the state races, who you vote for president, do you think?
It has in the past somewhat, but then in the other years, and this is such an odd year, I don't think you can count on anything.
That's a good word.
It is. It's plain odd, and it's. I think it's going to affect the way people look at the coming election.
You know, Minnesota Nice always likes a civil political environment, and I think what we're seeing right now at the Republican convention is a lot of incivility. I hope we don't see that in the Democratic, but as was pointed out,
it's going to be there.
It remains to be seen. And I think that will resonate poorly with voters. And so I think it can affect down ticket. And hopefully with a positive Democratic convention, it could have a positive trickle down. So we'll wait and see.
So what kind of messages are going to be given at the Democratic convention? What are we expecting to hear?
Well, I think, I hope that we don't hear the anger that we've heard the last couple days at the RNC. That's been very concerning to me. I tried watching it. I ended up turning it off. I don't like to see that anger and fear-mongering. And I hope we don't see the same thing. I anticipate talking about issues, what we will do to make changes in the economy and in security and safety of our country. So that's what I hope to see. We'll have to wait and see.
Has the Republican convention been satisfying as far as unifying?
I think it has. I think with picking Governor Pence, I think that brought in some stability to the whole equation. And the Democrat side, you have a lot of factions that are way to the left that scare the bejeevers out of most Americans, and that is out there in the forefront with Bernie Sanders pushing it. So when you bring that into the mix, I think that's why you got the negatives so high on both candidates right now.
What about the statewide races? Now everybody is up, right?
Look out.
Senate and House. Senate and House,
yes.
It's all, everybody's up for real. You are not running.
I'm not running, I'm retiring.
Retiring after service.
10 years.
So you can be totally honest now. What's the state of the legislature as far as decorum? There's a lot of back and forth.
It needs to improve, and I will say just this morning there was a tweet out there where Kurt Dowd said that, in fact, my seat will be one of the two most hotly contested seats they think they can win. And so, we have Dwayne Sauk running against Fran Bradley, who I replaced up at the legislature, and the other seat was Tom Anzell's, and I don't know if Bill knows who's running on the Republican side, but those were the two seats that he highlighted. So one of them here is in southern Minnesota.
Is there going to be a special session? I mean, we hear there's going to be one, because there's bonding money out there, projects all over the state of Minnesota that are kind of in, I don't know, limbo land or something.
Mm-hmm.
It just, they'd like to know one way or the other if it's going to happen.
I don't suspect that you're going to hear it too much before the primary. I think they're going to let the dust settle in the primary before they'll start getting serious about negotiations, because there's several people there that have primaries coming up, and they won't want anything to do with any kind of deal making. So it'll be after the primary here in the next couple weeks.
Have you heard anything from your leadership about what's going on?
Continued talk, but I have not heard of any decision that's been made. No one's approached us about what we would support or won't support, so I think we still have a ways to go before we know for sure.
Supposedly there's a groundwork deal done and they're going to build on it, but that doesn't mean anything
with
today's politics.
With light rail in it for the metro, is that?
That's one of the sticking points.
I think that is the sticking point right now going forward. Is the light rail and what it costs to maintain and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
And the ongoing expense.
So how about some of our local Rochester or Olmsted County races?
Yeah, that's what I was getting to. I think Dwayne Sauk, who's running for my mm-hmm. seat, is one of the hotly contested races, and I think he and Fran Bradley will be duking it out over the next few months to convince voters that they deserve that seat. So that's certainly one of them.
No, and I agree. That's probably the number one seat that'll be contested.
What about on the Senate side now?
Well,
Senator
those Senate
Nelson,
sides were
Senator Nelson and Challenger and Senator.
And they were
Carl
close
Nelson.
Last time, so I'm sure there's going to be a lot of money poured into this area.
Oh, were they close races? I'm not.
Yes, they were last time. Both, I think it was 3-4% each way, and so anytime you got a situation like that, you're going to see money come in. And unfortunately, Kim will agree with this. It's mostly the outside money, the special interest monies that. The candidates won't control, they won't control the message, and it'll probably be on the dirty side, and that's where the candidates get to look bad because they had nothing to do with it. And all of a sudden, these things are coming out. I remember there was one pamphlet came out, I think it was my favor one time, and was Bill Kuisle, the biggest SOB, and was strong on business was what it was stood for, but it said SOB. Man, you talk about being conversation fodder in the coffee shops. That was one. So, I mean, some of those messages sound good on paper until you hit the streets with it.
So, I mean, this is maybe a different conversation, but is there a way to fix that?
Well,
that
I'm
kind
involved,
of dirty campaigning?
Yeah, I'm involved in a group with the National Institute on Civil Discourse, and they have a program called Revive Civility that they're trying to roll out nationally right now because of what's happening in the presidential races. It's been very concerning. And we're asking local candidates to look at those standards and sign on and say, I won't run that kind
is
of
thing. Is that a website?
The National Institute on Civil Discourse does have a website.
Okay.
It's
but
national.
People like all that screaming and hollering. Isn't that why they watch?
I don't think they do.
I would kind of agree with you, though, because that's how they get the message out there. And if the public didn't like it, they could turn it off in a heartbeat.
I was being partially facetious,
but
that
did
does.
I dragged and people just said, I am so disgusted with the number of pieces of mail and it wasn't in my race, it was in someone else's race. There's so much negative mail, I don't believe any of the candidates and I don't read anything, and they just shut down.
And I think you're going to see that a lot this year, because I don't care if you're Democrat or Republican, it's going to get nasty at the presidential race, and the accusations back and forth are going to border on ridiculous.
Great and talking, guys. Thank
wow.
you both.
Yeah.
We had a run. Thank
yeah.
you very much.
Happy to be here.
Thanks.
And that's it for us today. Thanks for watching.
Keep those emails coming. We love getting your suggestions. Rochester@ksmq.org.
Stay cool out there and see you next time on Our Town, the show about Rochester.